For knitters. If you're coming back, if you're new, then welcome. My name is Kim and I am a yoga teacher and a knitter based in Central Alberta. I teach yoga classes online and in person and I love to knit. But knitting sometimes can hurt your body and that's why we do yoga, so that we can balance everything. Yoga's like knitting is your body as a knitter is the car. And the yoga is the oil change, the brake change, the car wash, all the things that keep your car running smoothly, or in this case, your body knitting to perfection. Just kidding. There's no such thing as perfection. So today's going to be a bit of a short one. I don't actually have anything new to show you. I've been working really hard on that cardigan because my mother-in-law's birthday is in 2 weeks. And I'd like to get it done. I'm kind of done on it. I really enjoyed it, don't get me wrong, but I'm ready to move on to the next thing. So I have sleeve number one and half of sleeve number two, which means I'm getting pretty darn close. The yarn that I used is a acrylic. I talked about it in the last episode because my mother-in-law doesn't like the feel of wool, but I'll be honest, this is so soft. It's so nice and I'm so tempted to make myself one as well. The only thing that is a bit tricky is that there's very good stitch definition. So if you make any mistakes at all, or even like I was weaving in the ends here, you can see it. I didn't realize it was gonna go through as bad as it did. So that was probably the first end that I wove in. And then it gets a little better as you move down. But even like you can even really see the decreases there. Just every little detail is very obvious. So, and it's a one color. So if you were doing like a beautiful cable design or something like that, it would really work well with this yarn, I think, because it would just show every detail so crisply. So I'm almost done. I've got to do the afterthought buttons. I've never done that before, and I'm a little bit excited and worried that it will or won't work. But at knitting group, we did talk about it, and they said, we'll just get clasps if these buttonholes don't work. So we have a plan B. And the other thing I'm gonna do is add an afterthought, or I'm gonna try it. We'll see if it looks good. An afterthought pocket, because I don't know that my mother-in-law really cares if there's a pocket, but the pattern does call for a pocket and I just missed it. So there is a way to do it after the fact. And so I will try that. And Smokey's here to say hello. He's such a friendly dude. Yeah, his favorite thing, if you don't know already, is to put his butt in your face. And my friend Adrian assures me that this is a sign of acceptance and love, but I think he's just being an a-hole.
What are you? Are you nice and trusting, or are you just a big jerk?
No comment. The other whip that I have on the go is, it still looks like, if you watch Vlogmas, I mentioned that this looks kind of like a something dirty, but it is actually a toe-up sock, and this is how far I got on the other one, and I'm just kind of picking away at it as I am. Not loving it, but I will finish it. I'm so excited for the next project, so let me tell you what it is. I haven't 100% decided on the color pattern yet, but I'm going to make the I think it's called the Hobbit vest, and it is for a dear friend is a new grandparent. And so I wanted to make this vest for that grandchild. Something acrylic so that it can wash and wash and wash. Probably something out of my stash. I have a lot of white, which stains. So I'm wondering if maybe my plan is to create some kind of pattern, black and white, and then knit some color work, and we shall see how it goes. I've not done that before, so it'll be a creative challenge, and I'm really excited about it. So that is my plan, and if that works good, then I'll make a second Hobbit vest for my friend who had a baby, and then the gift knitting might be done for a little while. Oh my goodness, he is stomping right on my sore leg, which is the good kind of sore, you know, the sore that you get after you work out. And I did a really long yoga class yesterday, and then we went skidooing because there is a pile of snow. Actually, I'll just show you what it looks like outside right now. We are driving down the road. Leela's filming this for me, and it is so hard to drive. Like, you were getting sucked into the ditch if you didn't stay in the ruts. But the snow is absolutely beautiful. The weather is just starting to warm up, and we're loving it. Last Sunday, I took a little walk about 20 minutes from my house down a long winding road to our neighbor's place where she hosted our monthly stitch day. We call it Stitchin' Sundays, or Welcome to the Stitcherhood. It was a beautiful day for a walk, at least until the end when it was snowing piles and piles again. Anyway, at these affairs, there's always plenty of amazing food to eat. So it is not a dieting sort of day. It's your day to eat whatever you want. And on display were all sorts of amazing crafts. Here you can see some weaving, a completed project, and then underneath you're gonna see where she's starting her next one. Just cool. This is an ankle loom that one of our knitters is working on. It's too complicated for me, but it looks really cool. She makes those straps. And then you can see there's plenty of knitting. There's plenty of crocheting. There's all sorts of good stuff going on. And we just visit and have fun. She's making dishcloth. She says that's the easiest thing to make when there's a bunch of people around. Some granny squares here. A Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer pillowcase. It's really cute. And thrummed mittens. I actually made these before as well, but I didn't make them quite as chubby as hers. They're so fluffy, and they will squish down on the inside, but boy, that's an answer to a cold winter day. If you've got some wool and you just knit these strands of wool in between your stitches, then the inside of the mitt is nice and woolly and warm and amazing. And then, of course, as it washes and wears, it'll felt a bit, but that just adds to the wind resistance. So you can see she's putting the extra bit of wool. She's just doing three strands of unspun in through. I believe she's working with a merino yarn. And it's, what'd she say, three stitches and then a thrum and then two rows. And yeah, you can see the inside of the mitt there is plenty warm. It's plenty, plenty full of woolly goodness. Carol's been knitting a long time. She's a pro. Yeah. So I'll just show you what the inside of a finished one looks like. You see how bulky that is? It's just so warm. And of course, the pièce de résistance. This was a needlework project. I believe she said it was 252 hours of love and dedication. What a beautiful project. So it's a winter wonderland. We're just enjoying it. It's we did have a bit of a cold snap, but it is kind of warming up now. And even though it looks like winter, the sun is up at 7 a.m, which makes it feel like spring. And Balzac Billy, our local groundhog on Groundhog Day, didn't see a shadow. So that means that hopefully winter will be over soon. But who am I kidding? We live in Alberta. It could snow in May, and it has. It snowed in August before. Yeah, that's why everything that we grow is in a greenhouse. And, you know, you can do your roots. You can do your root vegetables outside. But if you want, like, the fancy stuff, then you need a greenhouse. Because, boy, it's a tough climate to grow in. Speaking of growing, garden season is on the way. And actually, March the 1st is planting day for a few things. I've got like my Excel spreadsheet, my timelines, all the seeds that I ordered, when I'm going to plant them all. And I'm ready, except that I'm not really ready because I'm a bit tired and I'm not excited, and I should be more excited. But I think that's just because work is crazy busy these days. I try not to talk about work too much on these podcasts. As a matter of fact, I think that work is part of the reason why I love knitting so much, because at the end of the day, after work is over and I've made supper, everybody's fed, everyone's gone to their activities, and I can sit down and just, like, you know, internalize for a little while instead of always giving and going and doing. That's what knitting just makes perfect for me. I'm not even sure of the right words, but I think if you're watching this podcast, then you know what I'm talking about. It is just a refuge from the storm. Oh, my bread's beeping. Be right back. So for the last year and a half, I've been experimenting with sourdough and trying to find the easiest, most user-friendly way to make it, and a recipe that my family will eat, and one that will win me first place at the Ag Fair. I'm not gonna lie, I love our local little Ag Fair. I always like to enter some canning, baking, and making, you know, something crafty like knitting. And they opened up a sourdough category last year. I entered and justifiably didn't even place because that bread was horrible. However, I have tried a new recipe and I think maybe this might be a contender. We shall see how it tastes. I will put that out of the way so the cats don't get into it and look at it for the next half an hour. That's gonna be a challenge. Anyway, today's yoga class is all about the nerves. Nerves run through our entire body. Some would argue that the 72,000 nadis, or energy channels that they teach about in yoga, are actually 72,000 nerves along which your life force runs. Whether you subscribe to Western medicine or Eastern ideas, the fact is we have nerves, and sometimes they don't feel very good. Sometimes they don't work quite right. Now, when I use the word impingement, I'm working along a great big scale. Impingement here, where you need to see the doctor, have surgery, it's painful, you can't walk. We're not going to deal with that. That's something we're going to leave to the specialists. But when we go to the other side of the scale and we look at impingement as something that might be caused by inflammation, a bone spur, or tight muscles, that is something that we can nurture and take care of through our yoga practice. So our nerves do have a small amount of stretch. And when you do a traditional cat-cow, you're going to be stretching them slightly in one direction or another. And that's a good thing. We do a lot of cat-cow when we warm up in yoga class. But the way the nerves are created, they're designed to move, to slide like this. And so today we're going to do something called nerve flossing. That's right, flossing. It's just like when you have that piece of string and you're getting that food out from between your teeth. Nerve flossing will do a few wonderful things for our bodies. The first is that it increases nourishment to the nerve, because the nerve is a big part of our body and it cannot live in isolation, it needs blood flow and it needs waste removal and needs nourishment from our blood and oxygen to be healthy, to work properly. And so nerve flossing can increase blood flow and nourishment to the body. There's also some evidence, and the studies are still out there and they're doing them, about the fact that if a nerve is healthy and mobile, it can actually release enzymes or something else, release something that actually decreases inflammation. And that's pretty amazing. It can get rid of things that are in its way. So that's a very broad term, but that's what the research is pointing to. So anyway, everything is telling us that nerve flossing is a good thing. And it's a good thing for you knitters too. I'll show you how to do it. Come on into all fours. Okay. So we're gonna set up for a minute first with our knees right under our hips and our wrists right under our shoulders. And you're gonna press the pads of your fingers into the mat so that the mounds of your palms spring up, and then we're grounded and we're ready. We're going to move the spine in through cat-cow traditional movements because it's a great warm-up and it feels really good. So inhaling, we're gonna come into cow. Open the heart, roll the shoulders back, lift the face, arch the back, and tilt the hips up. And then you're gonna tuck the hips around the back, tuck the chin, and pull the belly button up toward the spine. Inhaling to cow, and exhaling to cat. Working through any tightness. As Jason Crandall says, knocking the rust off. I like to think we're blowing away the cobwebs, but any way you want to visualize it is good for you. We're just making ourselves feel good in our bodies. Remembering that our bodies like to move this way and that this is perfectly natural. We just kind of forget to practice every now and then. So you can go fast. You know, inhale, exhale, or you can go really slow. As long as nothing's hurting, then you're good. Be intuitive and listen to your body. Good, now come back to stillness just for a moment. We're gonna start to move a little bit more with this cat-cow movement. So start with your cow. Inhaling here, we're gonna move a little bit past our hands, not for long. And then tuck the tail, go through your cat, exhale, and pull the hips back. How far back you get is irrelevant. We just want to get into that motion. Maybe scoot those hands a little bit further forward. Inhale, cow a little bit further. And then exhale, cat. Now this should feel fairly natural. We're still moving through our traditional cat-cow, just in a little bit more dynamic way. And you may not get as deep into your back bend here in cow, but that's okay. Just move through those two positions and use your breath. Exhaling back, inhaling forward, exhaling back, inhaling forward. Let's do one more. Inhale forward. Now, I want you to come into your cat, and stay in cat as you pull back. Oh, that feels weird. You're not going to keep a big curve in your back, but it'll be kind of a natural feeling. Then, tuck the tailbone, go through your cat, and come forward. Cow comes back. Now we're flossing. Cat comes forward. Cow moves back. Takes a lot of thinking. Cat moves forward. So maybe guide each movement with your tailbone. Lift it up. Pull back. Tuck it under. Round forward. Lift it up. pull back, tuck it down, pull forward, and then close your eyes as you continue to move and visualize that nerve all the way down your spine is moving up and down, flossing itself through the spinal column. Use your abdominal muscles. Everything is abs. Last one. And we're done. So come to a seated position. And just for a moment, notice how you feel. Close your eyes. And bring all of your awareness to your spine, starting from the tailbone, wrapping through the sacrum, chugging through the lumbar, up along the ribs through the thoracic, and then all the way into the neck with the cervical spine. How does it feel? And then move your awareness out from your spine, down your shoulders to your hands, down your legs to your feet, across the belly, through the chest, and up into the head. I like to think it's kind of like tuning an instrument. You know, you got a string, it's out of tune, doesn't feel right, doesn't sound right, so you just adjust the peg, pluck, pluck the string until it sounds melodious, mellifluous, harmonious. That's what we just did for our bodies. So I hope that you have a wonderful, comfortable, mellifluous day. Thank you so much for watching. You can always find me on YouTube, of course, if you're watching here. I also have my own channel, Turning Ground Yoga. You can find me on Instagram and you can find me on Facebook. Thanks so much. Have a wonderful month. We'll see you next time. Namaste.
It's good.